Hello folks, I am Matthew, a board member, and let's get the open door started. Let's start a kerfuffle by going to William and Mike.
Well, thank you very much, folks. Welcome to the open board in Aberdeen. First time the open board has come. The first time the board has come to Aberdeen. A couple of housekeeping rules. We've got to do them for health and safety. If there is a fire or the fire alarm goes off, it is the real thing. There is no planned fire alarm today. The exits are there and they are. Now, the question is, which way do? You run that way or that way? You can go either way. But if you've got a wheelchair coming the same way as you went out. And I think it's Mike's turn.
We should also point out we've got our colleagues from Glasgow as well, also coming in via the Xbox contraption here in our houses. When we say open board, we mean really pretty much as open as you can get in there. So thank you. Right, settle down. We're talking here in our story. And it's about the transformation we've had as well from traditional based services to individual service funds as part of our continuing story of Sea Change Aberdeen. So at the beginning, 2013, when Sea Change Aberdeen started to work with some of our colleagues and people we worked for in a couple of locations in the city. We started off by trying to help folk work out what made sense and how we would work towards individual budgets, etc. So we started off by asking some questions, why is it done like this? What's working? Who gets what support? And it was at a time when we were building relationships with people that hadn't really got to know us. So it was about us evolving that and actually asking, what was it that you were wanting? In life as well. And do you want to talk a little bit about that, William? What are you looking for?
That sense of stability, okay. Happiness. Very uncertain to start with.
Okay. And we had quite a few conversations with folk about how we would work towards individualising people's support and teams and that. And we learned that people weren't necessarily happy with the current arrangements that they had at the time, and they wanted things to change somewhat. The quotes that we heard were things like, they want a better life, want to have more say and control. I'm not entirely sure what's happening in Glasgow. So part of it was about going through a process of working together and unpicking what was working and looking for listening to people's conversations and having face-to-face conversations as well about what folk were really wanting. I was asked, actually down to my first ever board meeting in Sea Change, and I was asked to describe what was Aberdeen like, and I had only been in working in Sea Change Aberdeen for a few weeks, and we kind of came up with a bit of a guddle. It was a bit of something that we had to work through and we had to gain people's trust. So we had lots of conversations with folks, and part of what we were talking about was saying, how would William want to perhaps manage his own team, and how would that look, etc. There was one thing to talk about, it was another thing to actually start putting into practice. So, it was a bit of a leap of faith, and unfortunately the graphics aren't very good here, but in the background, the gentleman who's just about to jump from bale to bale, where is he? There he is. There he is at the back there. You've seen him all suited and booted today. He was all mud and turf and all sorts then. First obstacle race, one of the things you were looking to do was to do more things, be more active. And this was about mile 3 of an obstacle race that we were doing, and it was about taking control and doing some things that challenged us. So we were asking folk to kind of believe in themselves and actually take some of the lead with that. It was about how we facilitated that as well. And one of the things we picked up as well was that, you know, it was individual journeys. And do you want to talk a little bit about that? Well, let's talk about, you know, how you were feeling at the time then when it was like starting to take the lead.
I'm starting to think I've taken the lead before, I suppose.
So yeah, so it was a bit of an uncertain time, and you know, it was about taking that leap of faith and feeling that we were enabling you to go with that. So from there, part of the journey was planning for all. No point in us sitting there and doing it all in that respect. So this gentleman goes to the first one to put his hands up and say, right, let's do this. Do you recognise him?
Yeah, I can. Let's do it now.
There you go. So, do you want to talk about like your planning and what we did?
I suppose kind of keep planning how the first one put my hand up. I'll go give it a go. I'm keen to give anything a go. First time, you know, you always learn in life. And it was really looking at what I wanted and where I wanted to go and not fitting me into tick boxes and so forth like it's always traditionally been.
So we went through the planning process, which was, you know, took an afternoon. And, you know,
it took a whole day.
The most of it did, didn't it? And from there we worked together and working out, you know, like call it like a service design is actually how do we change the conversation to start talking about looking at outcomes and what makes sense. But one of the things we also started with was looking at like natural support and people's connections to community and how we would work with that and enhance that as well. I think by the end of the day we had. You see, the flip chart paper on the walls was only part of it. It was all over the floor. It was attached to other walls, and it was really in depth. Slowly as well. So, however, one of the things we talked about is how do you just take a traditional model and change it whilst actually it's all still happening on a day-to-day basis as well. And one of the things that was a catchphrase that kept appearing was it's like trying to redesign an aeroplane while it's flying. It's not an easy, quick fix. It's not a 2-minute job, and it takes time and planning, and it takes input from all, you know, and that level of transparency there as well. So one of the things we took from that when we were working together was the working with our colleagues in social work and in health as well. Social work had taken the courageous step to actually say that we're not asking for the same to happen, but we're actually wanting to, you know, look at doing it differently and doing it in a way that makes sense to individuals and works towards providing the outcomes that folk are saying that they want to be working towards. So we worked together and created like a statement of intent that was just an agreement, a principle about how folk would work to put the resources in place, including time, conversations, etc., to help folk take the lead in their teams. 2013-14, folk became a lot more aware of human rights leading your team. How does it feel now to have a team and lead it? Okay. And what's been the learning from you in that?
Back to current journey.
Okay. Well, there you are. Kind of says it all. Part of the story was we actually took a pause around about year one. We had a party. Actually, Maggie's the Goat, before it had even been called Maggie's the Goat, was working on the cake, such like as well. We had agreements with Aberdeen City Council, and we started creating the shadow budgets, where we'd work with individuals, we'd put together a budget, and we were supported to be able to run them in the background to make sure that they were working for individuals. We were also privileged at that time to start working with the people we work for at Gardner Road and their families as well. And that was a significant part of the year. And one of the other things that was quite apparent when folk were enabled and taking the lead in their own lives much more is that folk were no longer subject to perhaps a lot of unnecessary rules and restrictions that had been in place because folk, they made up their own rules, etc. And we held individual service fund meetings. William, do you want to talk about your first time when somebody sat down and went over what we call an ISF, the budget?
Do you really want me to? Are you sure?
Cautiously. Do you want to talk about just how that felt?
Of course I will. Felt quite good to actually see what the budget had been spent on and to spot the mistakes of where the budget had been misspent as well.
Yeah, that's a fair point, because a couple of times we'd allocate money to the wrong spot, so William was able to say, that's not mine, so that'll come back out and go where it should be going.
So yeah, where's Julie? Julie, I'm coming for a shower, I've about 3 pence a week at Gardner Road since I've been paying gas for it.
It's a coding issue, we've got it fixed. And we also started working with our other partner organisations as well. I mean, we worked with Robert Gordon's University.
Archway,
yeah. We worked with Robert Gordon's University. We've had a couple of folk who worked for, in particular, Mr. McGregor here, has done some talks, which you'll be able to talk about later on.
Yeah.
To social work students in training. Worked with Aberdeen City Council. Helping World Cafe events and such like as well, the Shine Partnership, Values into Action Scotland, and also In Control Scotland as well. We've had several individuals representing Sea Change Aberdeen, Sea Change Scotland as well. So it's been a really busy time. It's been a very quick few years in some respects. But I guess the question has been, are we finished?
Well, of course we're not.
Not quite. Recognise that gentleman again, everybody's...
We're not being finished, are we? We might not be finished.
What we've done is we've done the transformation to individual service funds. So people are now in charge of their own budgets and are much more enabled by that. But equally, it's now about looking at folks' outcomes. And it's actually about enabling people to be more participative in the community, more out there, doing what you want to be doing, and being part of the community as well. On that note, I'll be able to hand you on to a lady and share everyone's experience of the Dragon's Den, and they'll talk to you about that.
Thank you. Okay, so the idea of the Dragon's Den was to give us an idea of what Sea Change is all about, and that's about folk living their dreams and having bigger aspirations beyond just support. So the Dragon's Den we had this year. I know we've done it before in Glasgow, but Maggie's going to tell us a bit about her Dragon's Den experience. So. You want to tell us a bit about your idea about what your Dragon's Den plan was?
I'd like to do boofies and tree bakes. So I want to have a business called Maggie's To Go.
Yes. So what was the idea behind that? What made you think that was your idea?
Because I used to work for another place, Rosie's To Go, mm-hmm. and that's where I got the name from.
Yes.
But instead of Rosie's...
You made it up yourself, didn't you?
Yeah.
So you knew it was the sort of job that you wanted, but...
I don't like people telling me what to do.
You don't like people telling you what to do, exactly, yes. So you were getting to be your own boss.
Yes.
So that was an important factor of the Dragon's Den, was being your own boss.
Yep.
That's part of what Sea Change in Aberdeen is all about. Well, Sea Change, all of Sea Change is all about, is being your own boss and having taken charge of your life and doing things that you want to do. So, if we look back to before Dragon's Den, 3 years ago, how was life when you first met Sea Change?
I'll keep it clean.
Keep it clean.
I'll be honest.
wait, a lot of swear words, but I got a hang of it. I used to have endless goofy days. I was worried about everything with the no change. I don't like change. Mm-hmm. It's just part of me. And sea change were rubbish when they first started.
Yeah.
It took a while to get it.
Yes, you didn't. I think that's one of the things, isn't it? You didn't get it to start with.
No.
It didn't make sense to you. And that's one of the things about the idea of, it was so different to your traditional support.
It's like people, when somebody says, oh, you've got a team.
Yes.
And you're their boss, and I'm like, no, I'm me.
Yeah.
So, did they like that?
Yes.
Still don't.
So it turned everything on its head, didn't it? You were like, that doesn't make sense to me. It's just support.
Yeah,
yeah,
that's all I want, it's just support.
Uh-huh. But, so moving forward, what we're able to do is try and help you, to hopefully, to understand that it's about listening to you, and that some of the things that seem scary were actually about putting you in charge. And
I don't like that.
And you don't like that as well.
Don't.
But what you do like is when it feels like you're in charge. Like for your own boss. You don't like that?
Yeah.
All right, I'll have to boss you about then.
Try.
So you did want to be your own boss. So some of the things that were strange as we were working through the changes was there was your own team.
Yeah.
And there was stuff around about when you got support and things like that, things, the sleep-ins, when folk were speaking about taking sleepovers away, that was a big scary thing.
That was a big scary, but now I've got an iPad that I do FaceTime and Skype.
Yep, and how's that working?
Half and half.
Half and half? And, but, so it's half and half at this stage, but would you have believed it was even going to be half and half before?
No, not really.
Not really, no.
I kind of miss the company of at night.
Yes.
And medication and things like that. Mm-hmm. And that's changed as well.
Mm-hmm.
Medication, we've got like a tablet machine. Mm-hmm. So it goes off and me and the staff fill it up on Sunday.
Uh-huh.
But it's broken just now, so we can't.
We can't. Yes, another technical brilliant.
I've got blue tack, we'll be fine.
No, it's completely broken. Ryan has not got it fixed yet.
So, that's a name and shame. Maybe Ryan can stand up for us. No. Okay, so, and this is part of the other bit, is that a lot of support services are about filling all the gaps and you feeling, because you felt you needed staff all around you.
Mm-hmm.
But actually, as things have gone on, you're the one doing the support. You're the one supporting other people and helping yourself by helping others.
I suppose.
You suppose? Can you think of anybody else that you help out? You're a good neighbour too, or?
I like all my neighbours.
Yep.
I got on really well with my neighbours. I love you, Zach.
Yeah.
And, you know, I would not move anywhere else.
Yes.
And if anybody moves me, I would be in trouble.
Yes. There we go. So, you're a good neighbour. You look out for each other. You even look after Bruce.
I'm the only girl in Zach.
Yes.
We call each other family.
Family.
We work together.
Families together.
And isn't that a great thing to have? Is to have people who you care about and who care about you.
Yeah. Alistair, I don't have family, so I class as them.
And isn't that that's got to work. So, when we're looking at how the Dragon's Den helps, it's something about building your confidence, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Because you've got the skills.
Yep.
Because you've done the course. You say what you've done courses about preparing food before and everything.
Yep.
And it's given you a bit of money to get you started.
Getting there, yeah.
Yeah, so we're going to have meetings over the next couple of weeks about putting that money in, getting the equipment and starting doing it.
I've got a list of
things to buy and stuff. so that's going to be good. And then we're going to get cards as well, aren't you?
Yeah, because a lot of people have asked me about business cards and I haven't got any.
Yes, so that's the next stage. So that the business, we're hoping the business will just grow and grow.
God.
And so this is a picture of Winner's Corner with the folks that got checks. Sean's there. And here's security guard man Sean. I thought it was only a matter of time before he started heckling. Sean, who does a security guard job up at Tesco's, he won his target stand proposal. There's Sandy and Elizabeth and Rachel with Darren's been there as well, and Maggie obviously. So, is there anything else that you wanted to say about either Dragon's Den or how Sea Change has changed? Or how
Sea Change has changed, but they still make,
mistakes, or we're still learning?
You're still learning.
Aye, we're still learning. We're right learning, and that, I think that's the most important thing, is that we're open to that learning, and we keep listening to you guys, and make sure that we don't confuse you with jargon, and it's stuff that's real, and all the stuff that we do reflects the stuff that's important to you guys, and helping you move forward.
It is important, and I want to help others,
yeah.
You know, with mental health and learning disability. Mm-hmm. So I want to employ people, mm-hmm. because they can't get jobs because other people put them down.
Yep.
And I want to help them.
That's brilliant. And I would say, other things that I've seen about how Maggie's come on, not just for the Dragon's Den, is like you would say about your other job that you're doing?
Volunteering at the office once a week.
Yeah.
And
the jobs that you do there?
Answering phones.
Mm-hmm. That's a great coffee. Mm-hmm. pieces.
Oh, aye. Definitely.
And would that have been something that you thought a couple of years ago you would have thought you could have done?
I didn't think that would ever happen.
No.
And this has been my dream.
Yes. It's absolutely. It's brilliant. And it's great because you're coping with lots of changes that you couldn't cope with before as well, because we've had...
I have my days.
Yeah, but you cope with new people, meeting new folk a lot better, and mm-hmm. and that's good. And that's, so it's been a really good contribution to the office, and when you're phoning folk up and asking where they are and getting themselves down to a meeting, it's great because they'll listen to you. You see, they're going to listen to us. Okay, so we hope you enjoyed your dinner, as they say, as it says in the art centre. So Maggie's obviously made all the food for lunchtime. You can always phone the Aberdeen office if you want to, the Aberdeen base, if you want to inquire about Maggie doing any other events. And I just wanted to thank you for your time and ask if there's any who's got any questions.
Please don't. I'll take any questions. Yeah. Well, as you heard from Mike and William about when we first came to see Sea Change Aberdeen, it was a bit of a goodall. And one of my first memories was working walking into Woodside, and every time we appeared at Woodside, Sandy wasn't to be seen. You were never there.
No.
And every time I tried to arrange to go and meet with Sandy, he was never there. And I remember thinking to myself, well, how can we try and catch up? And one of the things that Sandy had always said was he'd a lack of trust when he first met people. Because in the past, there was lots of things that you thought were going to happen and then they didn't happen. Yeah. So he didn't want to meet this new fancy company called Sea Change because we were all the same and we were all a waste of time. So a good couple of times we knocked at the door, and then eventually one day, I think, was it a Northern Hotel we went? No, I can't remember. We went somewhere for coffee. And just over that period, amongst I got to know Sandy,
And I think I should just let you do that now, because it makes sense. Is that okay?
Yeah. But if Herbacy Change was starting in Aberdeen, which of the bosses that came to the meeting, it was the big boss of the council. And a lot of us was advocating that this company started. We didn't know them, didn't know who they were. We don't know if we got to get on with them. So we asked the council, they were only like a country, but the cornerstone. But that was the question. But I didn't know Sam and Martin, which we got Glasgow at that time. The Glasgow company was Tassie Change. Never knew them. But I worked with Sam and Martin a year before I moved to Faberside, Elwood Hospital. Yeah. So, I thought we gave Sea Change a chance. There have been a lot of mistakes, you believe me, loads of them. We've been sacked Amanda, how many times we sacked Amanda? We took a batch.
I sacked last week.
Yeah, sacked last week, a week before. There's a lot of things went bad and wrong with the company. This company had to happen to a lot of companies. Yeah. So the good and bad they come. But I had I went to a board meeting in the main office in Aberdeen, and I spoke about the things with Rock, and I got Sam on Skype, and Mike says, can we talk about this? I went off a chest, and so I said things that it was really bad about the sea change. But after that, I've been in care since I was 8 years old, and till I was 19, and I went to a different place. I was 19 till I was 28, and I went back to that place, back to the Faroes before the BAM. So I've done over 37 years in institutions. My pal George here, in New Hampshire, when I was 8 and he was 12, and we've been best pals ever since. And I've got my new partner here, Rosie. Yeah, the love of my life. She's changed my life around completely. But, being here for a long time. Thank you. Being here for a long time, a lot of things have been bad, really bad. I've tried to harm myself so many times, from suicide, you name it. Being in there till I was 8, till I was 19, because I went to another place in Glasgow, near Glasgow, Lancashire. I was there from I was 19 until I was 28. And I tell him, if I ever leave Carstairs, I come back to BAM, I tell him, I'm the guy. So I move back to BAM, but say I come through Dundee, Glasgow, up to back north, they took the country roads, so I wouldn't care if I was going. As soon as I saw Mayfield, they took my hills, a big villa, it was a boys' unit, and I thought, I'm going back to these places as soon as that villa. But ever since, I've tried suicide again, you name it, didn't I like it. And then, when the lease was closed, in 1999 closed, and we went to a place called Woodlands. We were there for about a year, and then we moved to Elwood Hospital. And Alba Fee was still in our face, because at least place, you could wonder about the grounds, you could go to Elgin, or if Vanessa wanted to, that's near instructions. But as soon as it was closed, and then Woodlands for West, there was instructions for us to leave there as well. But as soon as we got to Elwood, that was our freedom to know. And now I'll do with the staff, you name it, shopping trips. It was a nightmare. And I thought, I'll never go to a hospital, I thought I was going to die in there. Then I had a neuropsychiatrist called Dr. Oliver. He gave me a chance. Either staff didn't want it, but I didn't. It was the first chance of me being, I felt my own. I've been there 2009, and I'm still there. It's amazing, but the first thing, there was lots of stresses in my life. Because I had my gas cooker was still in me, in my bedroom there was a fire alarm, and I had a table and a chair smoking. If I went up at 3 in the morning, me having a 5 hours, because my father's restrictions, I was on all the 5 hours a day. But every time I was out OT, I was hiding far the cupboard my father used to give me them. But that was a secret thing. I didn't say, but the cooker, instead of me having a lighter, so I had to switch off the cooker completely. Cleaning stuff is out of the cupboard. Everything was in a while, and it's like a prison in my own flat. I cannot move, and the staff are there. And I'm locked up after 10 o'clock at night. You need to hold it, because the other flats are alarmed, so I can't commute around. So it's a total nightmare. Since teachers took over, I had loads of goals. but there are met, every one of them. So, with this place didn't make me weaker, it made me stronger. Other things that my voice changed. How was that? I don't know. But, so that was part of my life. BBC changed because I went to work because I had no freedom, nothing. And since he changed over, ever since Alex changed, it started off, it was my care manager, I remember her name, she would work my work beaming and see how I got from work back home. And this time I was taking a bus for Woodside to my work morning place. We'd be staff at work, some stuff were a nightmare. Yeah, but I had no freedom at all. And then just to talk about freedom, 5 minutes after I walked, and the shops up the road, I tell you they have 5 minutes up, so I couldn't get the 5 minutes back. But that was it.
So
will
I speak a bit about what we did early days?
Yeah.
So as Sandy described, when we went to work for him, though he was staying in his own flat and he'd made kind of big step to moving from a ward into a flat, he still felt like he was a prisoner in his own home. And it was tricky at the beginning to try and identify what you needed. But yeah. I think spending time with you and really, really listening to the things that wasn't right and accepting that sometimes we were going to be making mistakes with Sandy, but the most important thing was just to keep listening to him and not judge him. Because I remember one of the incidents was when you went to Turriff.
Yeah.
And he decided he was going off. You were there as well, Moggy. You decided you were going to go for a wee walk on your own.
Yeah.
Which you had been able to do in Aberdeen, but that day, before you knew it, the police and everybody looking for Sandy. And when he came back to Aberdeen, he was really quite angry with us as well, with Sea Change, because he was, I think, would I be right in saying you were kind of trying to protect yourself because you thought you were going to get the blame?
Yeah, because of the member of stuff which we is. Yeah. I was, Avril was VS and it was a classic okay. And Avril knows, if it gives you enough time to be about a certain place, and we're there. But then, when I went to work, it was up there for about half an hour, and they didn't turn up. And then, I had a policeman and a policewoman, and I asked about if they could see Margaret and another two staff. I didn't say Margaret, but I can't remember if I said about you, but they asked two carers. If you see them, you can tell them and try to look for them. And then I went from there to the car park to see them at the end. I was there for about an hour. And then they turned up and the key gave me the lift and everything. So I disappeared. I walked to there in a quarry and I sat there in the quarry and I was there maybe an hour to an hour and a half. And then a policewoman at the top says, "We found him, he's safe and sound." And then Kay made me excuse the car because she said Margaret was upset, she's in a procedure and everything. And Margaret says, "No, I just want to beat you because I thought you had disappeared for good." And the police were great as well because they're good at listening to me. And then Kay started that thing up with Margaret. They didn't want me to go back to the car, but she wanted me to go back to the police van. But the policeman talked to me and says, "If we put your car, we promise in the head." And I said, "I'll behave and everything, I'll keep my promise." And I did. And then I thought they'll listen to Kay instead of me, because every time something goes wrong, it's always us that's wrong. Because they don't listen to us. We believe the staff before they believe us, and it's happened everywhere. But I was amazed how they took my side, because there's no staff or no doctors ever done it before. Just amazing.
So what we did from that is we listened to Sandy, and one of the things that Sandy said is, "When I'm upset, when I'm angry, don't keep hassling me. Just leave me be." And that's what we learned, and it was just over a period of time that we spent with Sandy that we began to realise that was the best way to work with you.
The best way with staff, and I used to tell them to go and give my phone when I need them, to let them come to. And there was staff still at flat, I'm near the quiet room on each side for a walk. That's the way I deal with it, but I don't like the staff to be angry. It's the same if family make me angry forever or upset. I don't want to seem like that, so I walk away from it and just going up as one. Rosie knows my my temper with Arrow. Every time I spent an Arrow was getting me higher and higher, and I had to walk away from it. Poor Rosie was a bit frightened because my voice was a big tone, but she stayed right enough. And yeah, and she always said I was the wrong at that time. Yeah, she should have stopped dead instead of carrying on. But that's how I deal with it. If I get a problem with stuff, I either look up or walk myself off, and I'll tell you my phone, and I'll really calm down. That's how you deal with it.
Yeah. Okay. So when we went to work for Sandy in 2013, he was 24/7 support. As Sandy described, he had to be back in his flat at 10 o'clock at night. It was like a curfew, and he believed that was what he had to do because of at the time you were on a
CTO.
But what we found was we couldn't even find copies of the CTOs, so we had to go and we requested them. And when we looked through the CTO, there was nothing to say that he had to be back in his flat by 10 o'clock at night. So that was one of the first steps that we looked at, was how we could support you to do your get out and about a bit more. So I, needless to say, when we met Sandy, he was really unhappy. No trust, little trust and support.
Yeah.
And he had no control, and he said he had no voice. He had no voice that was being listened to.
I was allowed to see family. It had to be organised to see family. I was allowed to my flat. I had to meet him in the tune. But see, as my family, if I could meet that certain day, then I got into trouble because I arranged them to, if I meet them, it shouldn't have happened. It's going to be organised for visits in the flat on the tune. And that's the minute Margaret get. Why can I need just order? Can ask him if anyone to come and just come, but not. It had to be organised and it had to be timed and everything. Yeah. So I didn't have a say in it. But the doctors, it's like a computer. I was like, I've got a microchip in my head. They could turn me off and turn me on. If I break down, just sort it. That's what I was like, Ken. They controlled my life. I had no control over it. They controlled my life, my job, everything. I didn't have a life. It was so bad. A bit inside, I had to abide by the rules of ever. It's the same thing in a teacher's class. I always bid by back by rules, must behave, you name it. And I thought, if I abide by the rules, how long will it take me to get help with hospital? And on no joke, it took about a year after I sat by rules, everything. But it was said, you've got a black set of rules, but like that far I had. As long as you're back a wee bit of rule, but need massive beans. So, yes, being in hospital and everything, you always got a black set of rules. You don't buy by them. As long as it's just a little bit, they're big things.
Okay. So when we went to work for Sandy, Sandy stayed in, it was like five flats?
There was five
flats. And there was one staff team that kind of went from pillar to post. So it was shared staff, and that used to cause quite a lot of stress because sometimes you would be expected to get your support and somebody would be in working with Maggie or working with Bruce or somebody else. And it didn't seem to have any focus on moving forward, and it seemed to be about what Sandy was describing about keeping folks safe. With the buzzers and the bells and but Sandy described you can kind of work some of the buzzers and bells and
I've cut a few wells in my time.
So
even when Margaret was my partner, because when this next door we could kind of night time we covers black. So I used to go out and then Margaret would come out and Margaret used to go in. And well, I used to shut my dog first and then pretend I was going to get mess. But no, I was going to Margaret's flat, we stayed there all night, you know. But then it would take longer to start put on if it was happening.
Andy, me and you did a fight, there was on you.
Eh?
Me and you did a fight.
No, George, we didn't, eh? No.
But every time it made you bid, George, you were always a good friend of mine.
Yeah. I'm a good friend of Artie's, George.
Yeah. It's a long, long time for you.
Aye, long time, George.
Aye. You're a good guy.
Yeah. Yeah, George, I'm going to get a big ass of it here. How many times did you escape from Elwood? Just something, then Elwood's never learned it, George. Yeah, you always use the same active. You use the garden bench. There's a gate in the garden, Elwood, there's a gate. And the garden bench is always there. Okay. And George puts, I guess, the door opens with the lock. Goes out locked over. It's kind of, they never sort of, every Saturday, George used to disappear. Then the hospital used to get a phone call to the pub we used to go to. Just to the pub, his mum and dad used to go in.
Then I give George ideas now.
Say that, George, say that, George. That's George. But that guy didn't check, that guy didn't visit, never moved. Yet the George has escaped, there's a lot of them, is there, George? But that guy's visit has never changed.
Yeah,
Gareth. Remember Gareth? He just got in that. But the police never called him down because he Gareth would come back the same day. Gareth is like a disappearing act because nobody knows how you go with the wind, because the wind is at the top of the lock. That's how to go out there. Yeah, Elwood has got the characters in there. Aye, for Bally. He was stuck up the roof, they get the fellow to get him to get a bath. He was stuck up the roof. Yeah. It's amazing. Elwood's a fellow characters in the George. Yeah. Yeah. The fellow characters and the staff are just.
So when we went to work with Andy, we did some planning, a bit different from what William did, because William decided he wanted an actual planning day, but we worked out that's not for everybody, and so Andy was quite adamant that he didn't want a planning day because his experience of planning would be that everybody went in the room and made the decisions about what was best for him, and it wasn't about him at all. So what? Me and you met over it was about 6 weeks, was it?
Yeah.
And Andy came up with his plans, which was to move out of supportive housing, go on holiday abroad, to get a pet, to get a job, have a relationship, take his own medication, and have more control of his own money. And I remember sitting at a time thinking, it's nothing fantastic, it's just about getting a real life. It wasn't anything fancy, it was just getting a real life. So what we did to start with was, we helped Sandy make up his own recruitment ad. We made your plan. We developed a service design focusing on the future. We individualised your budget from a big pot of money so that you knew how much exactly you needed. And we supported Sandy to develop risk-enabling support so he could experience life. And we've done this presentation a few times now, but we always say that was the most tricky bit, was it?
I think the first thing was in the Inverness. Talked to a lot of people. But by me, I'm used to talking to a lot of people, so I get nervous and nothing because I'm so used to it. But sport advisors, when they go to this meeting, they're totally nervous and everything else. But I've done a lot of this. I did a bouncer's night at Leeds Bridge where about 500 people turned up, and a lot of doctors and all nurses used to work at Leeds Bridge. 500. My fiance at that time was a lassie called Cathy, but she sadly passed away. Me and Cathy was gone for 7 years, and no, 7 years engaged and put 4 years together, but never actually with each other because we're in different wards. She took in the haggis because she was supposed to go in the haggis head. I said the grace in front of those people. But being in a lot of our meetings at this bridge, Little Lynch, you name it, and I'm so used to it.
So, to put that into perspective, we used to go to what we call CPAs,
or an MDT with Sandy, and as Sandy described, he went in as cool as a cucumber, and I used to go in a nervous wreck, because we used to go in and try and look, it was, can we go in with a risk assessment and say, Sandy would like to do this, and the first couple of times that we went, it was no. And then we started to change the way that we presented the risk assessments when we used to go into the CPAs, because we used to go in and say, right, this is what we're going to do, and this is a plan. And that's when we started to get a bit more, when we worked with our colleagues in health and social work. And we had to work on trust and help Sandy learn by his mistakes, because that was what kind of we found out pretty early on working with you, is that, as you can see, this gentleman's a skilled speaker, he can speak for himself, but he just needed somebody to help you.
We were, and just like people worked in farms and this stuff, I did need a lot of support. I like to do things on my own with me and Rosie. Sometimes I need support because Rosie isn't fairly. So when I go to a coffee shop or another shop on the road, because every time I go to a farm, then Rosie's there to discuss it herself. And we used to be in the same shop, and the one person buys Rosie something, she's there, she's over and buying it. But my support candidate is good because then she could take Rosie away, give her a shopping, and then we meet up for lunch or coffee. So it gives me a break on my own and a better time for Rosie to deal with somebody else. So that's how I work. And as I say to staff, if I'm doing shopping, you're doing shopping. I don't want staff to be there doing nothing, can't afford to wear shopping things. So it's great because then I could do my own shopping and they could do shopping with Rosie. So that's kind of where I like to work. And the staff, the staff are always prepared to swear, but I said, yeah, I love self-swearing. Once it's important, they hurt other people. That's the kind of fun I like to do, because sometimes you do need a swear word, but in fun, as I say, that hurt other people.
So as we said there, that when we were, once we'd done all the planning, done all the work with health and everything, you had your, what we call an individual service fund, an ISF in short, and we looked at what paid support Sandy needed, but we always kind of looked at what things you could do yourself first, because that was really important to you. We looked at other opportunities for you to use your budget that linked into his outcomes. It wasn't all about paid support, it was about looking what you could get that you didn't have to pay for in terms of getting.
Yeah, because as you see, there was some issues at the time because there wasn't enough staff to support me at that time. But now I don't have agency, and I've got another support worker called Jake. But Jake has made a lot of mistakes as well. Sometimes I don't have any support there, but sometimes I just lock my door. But it happens. I thought there was one mistake, but no, it still happens. So don't laugh. And just the Jake, and a lot of chiefs, bosses, and their managers, you name it, it still happens. But if it happens, I just lock myself, but I didn't even talk to them.
So one of the things that Sandy used his ISF was he planned a holiday looking at no paid support, because he really wanted to go away without a paid support member of staff. And I think 3 years ago, if we were going to be brutally honest, we didn't think that was going to be achievable.
No.
So one of the things that we did with Sandy's advertised for a holiday buddy. So we had a lady who's not here today actually, but I thought she might be, but she's not, but a lady called Flo, who volunteered to go away with Sandy, and what we did was used some of Sandy's ISF to pay for her holiday, but he didn't have to pay her hourly rate. Kind of, you looked for somebody that had similar interests.
Yeah.
You don't need that now.
No, I went to Ireland, me and Rosie went to Ireland, but do any support and any staff ever. And we managed to cope with it. But I think on them, we were there Tuesday to Friday. It was 4 days on the way, because it's Father's Day. We gave us a sea change of phone, this is Wednesday. Can we get a flight home? It was so boring, because where we went, we were at a hotel and it had little shops, like corner shops and
coffee shops, but I was near the little store. I was asked about the hotel, and I said, is there a new big store better than this? He said, no. And then on a Wednesday night, when we phoned to go back, talked to the lassie at the bar, and she says, yeah, there's a bigger shop, and it's only 9 minutes away on the bus. And again, half a minute was gone anyway, so we only had one day in the shops, that was it. No. But that guy said, there's no big store.
The good thing was that you worked it out on your own.
Aye, yes, we did, yeah. We just went back early on the Wednesday, so we're supposed to come back on Friday. But it was so bored, I'm going to go back. Yeah.
So why do we think it works?
Well,
we think it works, you can tell us how you feel, but think it because we'll listen. Even though we make mistakes, and Sandy will tell us, we get brilliant customer feedback. Yeah, yeah, with a clear service design for outcomes. The support's flexible.
Yeah.
It came from an approach that nothing is impossible. And we've always been honest with Sandy, and I can, as I said, Sandy's incredibly honest with us. And we're transparent with Sandy's budget. You've had your ISF, like William described. Yeah. You've had your meeting. So. Like that one. As we said, you've seen Sandy's outcomes. As he said, he's covered them all. And it's not over yet, is it?
No, it's over yet. I'm still thinking about my goals. So it's over yet. Yeah.
What's your biggest one, your aim at awards?
Is own flat for me and Rosie together.
Yeah.
So my name's Anna. I'm the project coordinator for Dates and Mates Aberdeen.
I'm Sarah, and I'm the director of Dates and Mates Aberdeen.
And we've got Richard, who's just sitting down here, who's one of our members of Dates and Mates Aberdeen. So we're going to have a quick chat with Richard a bit later. Okay. So we're coming up to our first anniversary of being up in Aberdeen. So I put together just a quick presentation showing some comments and other feedback we've had from our members this year, an overview of the highlights that happened with Dates and Mates Aberdeen, and also what's coming up. So, as most of you probably know, Dates and Mates is a dating and friendship agency for adults with learning disabilities. We're a project of Sea Change Scotland. And to join, to be a member, you have to be 18 or over and have a learning disability. So lots of our members join for friendship, some join because they want to meet someone special, some join for both. A lot of people join because they may feel a bit lonely, they may feel isolated, some may just want to do something different, they may be doing the same things each week, and they want to broaden their social horizons and meet new people. So we put on a wide array of events, do about 3 a month, so people can come to all of them, or some of them they can kind of choose, but all these events on offer. We provide a much needed service, and Liz Slurry, who is one of our members, says, I've waited such a long time for Dates and Mates to come to Aberdeen, and now you're here, I'm loving every minute. So we are the only dating and friendship agency for adults with learning disabilities in the whole of the northeast of Scotland. So with the emphasis really being on dating, that's our unique selling point. We've got a lovely comment from another member, Chris Scott, who says the cupcakes are great. He's speaking about Valentine's party, so. Nice seeing people I know. We always provide cupcakes. So it's nice seeing people I know, and I enjoy the dancing and the help from the Dates and Mates staff. So all of our events are like big parties and discos, particularly the big open events. We have lots of members who love getting up and dancing. It's really, really good fun though. Before I go on to this, I thought maybe I would just ask Richard, our member, one of our members, a few questions about Dates and Mates. So Richard, what do you enjoy most about Dates and Mates? What does it mean to you?
Meeting a new partner.
Meeting a new partner?
Yeah, making new friends and joining events.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. So what's your favourite event to come to?
Mm-hmm. like all the quiz night.
Quiz nights, yeah. You like the discos as well?
Yes.
Right?
Yeah.
Richard came to our to Glasgow's Cayley, which is the first national event, which I'll be speaking about in a minute. That was a fun, eventful evening.
Yeah.
So we'll speak about
a lot of walking, but it was fun.
Yeah, it was. and has Dates and Mates had an impact on your life, on your
yes.
social life?
Really good for me. I enjoy it and enjoy the company as well. So.
You enjoy the company,
yes.
meeting new people?
Yes.
Yeah?
Yeah.
That's really good. Okay, thank you. So this is just a few statistics from Glasgow's Dates and Mates. And they've said that 97% of our members said they have made new friends with Dates and Mates. 97% said being a member has increased their confidence, and 91% of members said that they have tried new experiences since joining Dates and Mates. So these are all really positive, great figures. And at Dates and Mates, we do encourage people to try new things. So just the other month, we had a sporting event, and one of the activities was trampolining. And one member came up to me and said, "Anna, I'm far too large, I'm not getting on that trampoline, you can't make me, and I'm going to break it." So I said, "Of course you're not going to break it, these things are designed for all sorts of weights, it doesn't matter. If you want to have a go, try it." And she did, and you couldn't get off that trampoline. You had to queue to get on the trampoline after that. And she said to me after, if you hadn't suggested I try it, I wouldn't have. So that's kind of what we're all about, getting people to meet new people and just try new things as well. And hopefully find someone special if that's what they're looking for as well. Okay, so I'm now going to quickly speak about some of our highlights of our first year in Aberdeen. So what better way than to talk about the launch event? So we launched Aberdeen Dates and Mates with a bang back in June 2015, last year. So I'm going to hand over to Sarah, who was at the event. I wasn't at the event. But Sarah designed the cake and she's going to speak about the event as well.
So I helped launch Dates and Mates Aberdeen last year, and over 150 people came along, and there was a choir involved, and I noticed that since the event, like, I noticed a few people that wanted to become members were actually part of the choir, so that was really good. Guests were welcome to come along to our civic reception at the Aberdeen Townhouse, which was before the launch party at the Rocks Hotel. And there were a few people doing speeches, including myself and John Paul, who's the director for Dates and Mates Glasgow, and Sam Smith from Sea Change.
Yeah, so apparently it was a really, really great event. Definitely kickstarted Dates and Mates up in Aberdeen. These are just a couple of pictures from some of our big kind of open events. So we do around 4 or 5 open events each year where anyone is welcome to come along. A lot of our members bring friends to these events, or people who are perhaps interested in joining Dates and Mates are more than welcome to come along to these events. They tend to be the seasonal discos, like Christmas, Halloween. We did a Halloween party. We did a St. Patrick's karaoke, which is really good fun, and a Valentine's party as well. So they're really good fun events. Back in January this year, we did an evaluation day. This is a really good, fun, productive session. So we invited our members into the office just to get feedback on the project, you know, asking what we're doing well, what we're not doing well. We wanted all sorts of feedback. We did actually get mostly really lovely comments. And we got a bit of constructive criticism, which is always what you need. For instance, some members said it would be good to get the map on the back of the invite to where we're going, so that, you know, where the bus route is. So we now do that with every single invite. We make sure we have that on the back, just so they know where they're going. Just things like that. We also encouraged members to give ideas for future events. And we actually encouraged members to take part in running Dates and Mates. Whilst I'm on that topic of member involvement, we've just started a new volunteering scheme called Dates and Mates Champions, where members can gain points each time they help volunteer. So you can help volunteer at events, you can suggest venues for next events at our coffee and cake committee. You can contribute to the newsletter, so Maybe you've been to a really fun event, you took some cool pictures, or you want to write a few words about that event. We'd be more than happy to publish that. You can also just be simply a friendly face at events, which is where you welcome new members and make people feel at home. It can be a bit of a scary experience if you don't know anyone, you've just turned up to a new event. So friendly faces are really valued as well. If you want any information on volunteering with Dates and Mates, I've got some information that you can see me afterwards and I can show you that. So this was our Meet and Mingle night, brilliant night just a few weeks ago at the Cotton Club. This is one of our first kind of events focused not only on friendship but dating as well. Everyone is entitled to a relationship and it was a really positive night actually. We did a speed meet, so everyone had to sit opposite each other for 5 minutes.
That was fun.
Richard was at that one. And Richard, I think you may have even found a date, didn't you, that night? Yeah, we've made some connections. So that was a really fun event. And actually, everyone left having spoken to absolutely everyone there, which is really also important. So many people go and sort of stick with their groups or stick with people they feel comfortable with, but this really took people out of their comfort zone, but in a good way. It was a nice event. So lots of people made new friends and new connections with that. Going on to our Cayley. So there was a Cayley down in Paisley, which is the first Dates and Mates Scotland national event. So Dates and Mates is now offering national membership to all members. The cost of that is £90 a year, which I think is about £7.50 a month or something like that, so it's not too much more. And as a national member, you get invited to all the Dates and Mates activities around Scotland. So we've got a Dates and Mates Aberdeen, Glasgow and Renfrewshire now, which only started a couple of months ago. So it's a really nice thing to do. So you can meet new people, go to new cities, broaden your social horizons. So there were about 15 of us that went to this Glasgow Cayley. It was a really good night. Alistair came, Sarah, yes. And you, Richard, maybe a few others here.
Like I said, there's a lot of walking, but we're fun in the end.
There was a lot of walking. I think we got really fit from that night and from Cayley. But we just want to promote kind of people getting out the house, but also seeing new things, going to new places, meeting new people. What better way than be a national member and expand your social horizons that way. Again, I have information if you want to become a national member, if you are already a member. I know there are a few people here that are Dates and Mates members, so that's nice. Okay, and these are just a few member-only events coming up. So this month we've got a basketball fun day at the Beach Leisure Centre, run by one of our staff members, Rebecca, who's actually running the whole event herself anyway. And that's on the 21st of May. And we've got a fun quiz night at Campus Bar on the 25th of May. And then in June, we've got various things happening that not all of them have dates for yet, but they will be posted out soon. So we've got the meal out. We're going to do a coffee and cake meeting where we encourage members to come and feedback on the dates and mates. We're going to do a baking event at Sea Fine Kitchens, just next door to the Dates and Mates office. It's actually a really fun. And we've also got plans for a one-year anniversary celebration for Dates and Mates, so we're keeping secret about that, but information will be out soon. Has anyone got any questions? Do you want to say anything?
Any questions?
But otherwise, thank you for listening.
Good afternoon, thank you all for coming. We're just going to do a lot of talk about giving back to the community for some good work that the community did for us at Gardner Road. Amy will start you off by telling you how we got involved with Aberdeen Foyer. Mm-hmm. Oh, Jamie.
So myself and Ryan, another support advisor, went down to meet and do a talk for volunteers to come and work for Sea Change Aberdeen. In the process, we met Kath Monroe, that's her name, is it? Yeah. And she had explained about her outreach support groups, which is the REACH programme, and that we needed a community project for They do a 12-week project, and for 2 weeks of the project, they needed to give something back to the community, do something in the community. So we began by speaking to Julie, and had a meeting with Kath and her youth support group, and Angela came down with us, and we had a cup of tea and had a chat about it.
So, as Amy said, I went down with Amy to meet Kath Monroe, which is an amazing woman. She was supposed to be here today, and I'm not sure if it's happened because she's actually on annual leave, but she's getting come in for her holidays. But not sure if it's happened. She's getting to get a couple of the guys that did the work for us at Garner Road, because they did an amazing presentation at the university. So anyway, Angela and I and June, no, Angela and Italy, we're doing to meet Kath at the foyer, and she told us about this group of adults who's been out of work for some time. It could be through long-term mental health, physical health, addictions, and they're trying to get back into the working environment. Their aim was to put them back into the community. So we agreed that Garden Road's garden was a bit of a tip. It wasn't very pleasant for the guys to sit out in the sunshine, although we've got a massive garden. It wasn't very friendly or warm and welcome. So Kath explained that the guys did a 12-week programme, as Amy said, and each of that 12 weeks they do some classwork, which they do health and safety, they do food hygiene, but they also go into the community and do a work project. So they volunteer to come to Gardner Road. So next slide. This is roughly what our garden looked like, apart from the bench. They're newer bench, but we had a lot of overgrown bushes, we had a lot of rubbish in the back of our sheds, and it wasn't very pleasant. So the guys came up, the Kath phoned and said, right, we'll be up, and I can't remember the date, it's on here somewhere. When I opened the door, we got invaded, and I mean invaded. The staff here will tell you, there was about 18 folk come in, and we was like, oh, we didn't even have enough chairs. But that came in, they were very welcoming, we were so eager and keen to get going. We had one lovely lady and the rest were our gentlemen. So this is the kind of thing, this was on the 18th of February they were going to start. So they had a look through the garden and they were just absolutely buzzing with ideas. So it said where it was everything, it's going to log in, bird feeders, we're going to be doing painting, tidying up the garden. So they said they were going to go in and fundraise to raise money to provide everything we needed for the garden. So off they went, and they actually did, I think it was a 100-mile stint at the gym. So it was it 100 mile? So they did run bikes, walking machines, running machines. You know, they raised over £640 for to do work in Garden Road. So this is where team, the starting date was the 7th of March. This is where team it came, and then they go flying. This is where the work that they did. They were just, I mean, they came for a fortnight, and they worked their butts off. This is different pictures of what they've done. So they did our fences, they painted our shed, were seats, were flower boxes, they've got hanging baskets, they've got sensory items. The transformation, this really doesn't do it justice. You need to come and visit us up at Gardner Road and see our lovely garden, because it really is. Is it?
Planters.
We made a new path.
They put slabs down, yeah. So all the way around Gardner Road, the service is accessible for the wheelchairs to go all the way around it.
In the back garden was just a bit of grass that couldn't be wasn't accessible for the guys in the wheelchairs. So they were limited to where they stopped. So now we've got a path right round. So it's really accessible. This was the deal, this was my deal. They came and did the work and I would mark their dinner. I should have actually kept my mouth shut. Because on a daily basis for 2 weeks I had to mark soup and sandwiches and burgers and pizzas for about 18 folk. But an absolutely amazing bunch, they really were. They really worked immensely hard, they did us proud. And when they came out for their lunch, they came and joined in with the guys that got on the road. With Leanne, Angela, June, Alistair, everyone. They came and they socialised. They had Irene out in her wheelchair, spinning about the front garden, whirling about. She was so excited. At one point I thought, only a minute now, poor Irene's going to go flying. But no, she held on and off she went.
And one of the ladies that did the programme is now filled in a volunteer application to come and volunteer up at Gardner Road.
Yeah. And also there's another couple of them, Michael and I think it's Darren. It's quite willing to come up and do any work we went in the garden. They said if you went painting done or come back
inside
and do
the
garden,
the
high inside work. So they get come back. I've got their phone numbers on speed dial. So there we go. As I said, two weeks of hard work and sweat. The work was completed. We were really grateful. I felt that they should be acknowledged for their hard work. So I phoned our local press, the Evening Express newspaper, and asked them if they'd come and do a story on the guys. And also about, they were giving something back to their community, and we was giving something back to our community by helping these guys get back into the working environment. So it was, Kathleen was saying, it was like two charities coming together and making something wonderful. So the Evening Press came up, and we got our photos are taken. We chased John. John was about with Alistair, and I walked and would say to him, get back here now. So he had to run out of my dune for the trauma in Cork with Alistair to get his photo. So at the end of it, the work was finished, and then a week later, Kath phoned me and asked me if I would go to the university and do a presentation. The guys were getting presented with their certificates for their classwork, so they had loads of certificates to get. So Patricia, one of the team at Garner Road, and June and Angela and I went to the university for a presentation. It was just because we just now, June clapped on cue. Every time somebody went up on the stage to get their presentation, she gave a big round of applause. Yes, did. And at the end of it, I was given an envelope with another £200 towards something for our garden. So we're going to buy a barbecue and some garden lights, and we're going to have an open invitation in the summer. Bruce Davis, he was looking for us an invitation. So we're going to have a barbecue this summer for everybody to be welcome.
Throwing like shrimp in the barbie, then she loved.
We'll get another sausage thrown on and a bat. So it's been such a worthy cause. It's been really good, as I said, two charities coming together to make something worthwhile. This is thank you from Alistair, Angela, June, Irene, Leon. This is photos we've taken at some of them around the garden earlier, which is a bit boring, but it's, you can see very plain. Now they can go out and they can listen to the sensory twinkly things. We've got ducks and things.
Ladybirds.
It goes boing. The fence at the back is just the most amazing colours. And it's a pleasure to go and sit in. Thank you.
Well, that's it, folks. We've heard from various people in Aberdeen. We've heard from Maggie, we've heard from Dates and Mates, we've heard from me, you've heard from Mike. I think at some point we've heard from Alistair. We've heard from Amanda. Just to say thank you very much for coming from Glasgow. I believe there's somebody in the room from Edinburgh. Where are you? If the SNP do get their way, please come listen to my line up the Major Trauma Centre. And thank you very much for coming. And a safe journey home, but in the words of Porky Pig, well, well, well. That's all, folks.